Great to have you along. Hockey Night Online. Of course, senior writer over at CBC Sports, Mike Brophy. I am David Amber. Plenty of action last night, and it was pretty exciting action if you were watching the Bruins and, of course, the Canadiens. We'll get to that in just a matter of moments, but we always want you to reach out to us. It's an interactive show, bro.
Exactly.
You got to engage with the viewers, and this is how you do it. At Hockey Night, at David Amber, at Hockey Brophy. Hashtag Hockey Night, all of those things through Twitter and then on Facebook as well, Facebook.com/Hockey Night in Canada. Okay, in case you missed anything last night, exciting action, the Bell Center. What an electrifying
scene that was.
That
is the greatest place to watch a hockey game of all time, in my view.
It was exciting, and they loved this. 1-0 Montreal, PK Subban sprung out of the penalty box. Look at that move on Rask. They go on and win. 4-2 is your final. PK styling and profiling the Canadiens up 2-1 in that series. Meanwhile, a huge game for Mini. They're down 2-0 in this series. They score 4 unanswered in the third and win this one 4-0.
That kid can score nice goals, can he, Granlund? Holy moly.
Yeah, so now we've got a series there as well. The home team has won all three games. Chicago still with a 2-1 series lead as they look to defend their Stanley Cup championship. But let's start with the only Canadian team in the postseason, the Montreal Canadiens. And we've seen now them play 7 games. They've won 6 of the 7 games.
Should be 7-0, shouldn't it?
Yeah, right. They blew the 2-goal lead to Boston in the last 9 minutes. Are you seeing something different from this Montreal team than you saw during the regular season?
Well, it's a confidence thing. And I've actually seen this building over the last couple of years since Mark Bergevin took over the hockey team. He changed the grain of the team. They're a little bit more edgy. They've got the speed that Montreal Canadiens traditionally have. I've said before about this team, they have a bunch of medium-sized players, but a lot of those guys don't play a small hockey game. They go out there and they play a fearless game. So yes, I'm seeing the calmness of Carey Price, who a lot of goaltenders would have completely melted down after that Game 2 defeat to the Boston Bruins when they had the big lead. Yeah. Not Carey Price. He just has a calmness about him that I think really influences the rest of the hockey team.
Yeah, he just shrugged it off and said, hey, it was a game. I lost it, and
we move along. I've got a couple dogs I have to go find.
Yeah, and here we are, and he got the dogs back, got the win. Montreal with a 2-1 series lead. We'll have more as well on tonight's game, Pittsburgh and the Rangers, a pivotal game 4 at MSG. But let's get to our viewer questions. Again, you get interactive here. You log on, you find us on Twitter and on Facebook. And one of the questions comes courtesy of Calcon, who wants to know, Thomas Plekanec was the best player on the ice in Game 3. Why wasn't he picked as one of the three stars? Torrey Krug, really? And you know what? Plekanec did have a big game.
Well, he certainly did. And I'm one of those guys who feels that Plekanec is not your prototypical number one line center, much like the Toronto Maple Leafs with Tyler Bozak. And yet, at a critical time of the year, he steps up big time. Now, on the game sheet that I looked at, it was Subban, Price, and Weiss as the three stars, not Torrey Krug. Nevertheless, Thomas Plekanec is a guy who, he really fits that description, David, that I was talking about. He's a medium-sized player who doesn't play a medium-slash-small game. He's not afraid. And to me, that's one of the critical elements of the Montreal Canadiens facing the Boston Bruins, mm-hmm. who, you know, they've got that tag, Big Bad Bruins. I'm not sure they're as big bad as the Bruins from the 70s that really earned that tag, but they are a much more physical team. And I said all along, if the Montreal Canadiens tried to get in a slugfest with the Bruins, they'd be in trouble. But as long as they can go out and not play as though they're intimidated, they've got a chance. I still think the Bruins are the favorite in the series, but I give the Montreal Canadiens a lot of credit for what they've accomplished so far.
It's been great, and you know what? Don Cherry made a good point last night. He said, don't poke the bear. Once
exactly.
you poke the bear, you wake them up, and if they start playing that aggressive Bruins style, Montreal can't compete on that level, but when it comes to just straight hockey and playing hard and skating fast, right now, unparalleled, a 2-1 series lead. Plekanec, by the way, beautiful pass there from Thomas Vanek. And you mentioned Mark Bergevin. Picks up Vanek, yeah. picks up Weaver, picked up one other player near the deadline that's been a huge bonus to the Montreal Canadiens. Its names, of course, is
Dale Weiss. Right?
Dale Weiss, that's yeah. exactly it. So, I mean,
two game winning goals.
Some great moves there by the Habs GM. Another question rolling your way, this one courtesy Suzanne Perry. So two questions here. Should have been a penalty shot. Ref slacked on a few calls tonight, next time. So it's more of a statement there. And I think yeah. the reference there is to PK Subban knocking the goalpost off in the final 2 minutes. Your thoughts on what happened there, as well as this. Will the Habs be wearing their new black and white striped jerseys for the remainder of the playoffs, courtesy of Scott Nickel?
I like that comment. That's pretty funny. You know, mm-hmm. we always talk about the officiating in the playoffs because every call is so critical. It's funny, like when I saw that play originally with PK knocking the net off, I thought to myself, okay, the puck's going behind the net. He's a right-handed shot. Mm-hmm. Watch the way he goes. He's a right-handed shot. Of course he's got to reach back. There's every chance in the world that he's going to hit the post. Then the more I watched it from different angles, I've got to say, you know what? PK's a pretty smart guy. And I think he saw an opportunity. But if I was the referee, I quickly would have said, you know, a left-handed shot gets to reach around the post. A right-handed shot reaching for that puck has to go through the post. I would have given him the benefit of the doubt. Oh. As for the officiating, I don't know. I mean, it seems to me like we get letters and statements on Twitter about the officiating every game. I think these guys do the best job they can. There are mistakes that are made, yeah. But I don't think the referees favor one team over another.
I don't think that at all, although I will say to the letter of the law, yeah. As the rule states, that I guess should have been a penalty shot, and it's certainly one Bruins fan, I imagine, pointed that out there. It's a tough and thankless job to be an official in the National Hockey League, and never easy calls. 15 seconds left, that would have been a pretty ballsy call, especially in Montreal to make.
As you say, though, if you go by the letter of the law, it's a pretty easy call.
Yeah.
Really. You just, hey, it's in the rule book, call it.
Yeah, so, you know, adds to the drama as we lead into a game four. Once again, some more viewer questions on what was a pretty dramatic Montreal Canadiens 4-2 win. Again, a lot of statements here, and Jeffrey DeFont just says, how good is Pricey? Obviously, Carey Price. How good? So how good?
Well, I mean, he's been amazing in this year's playoffs, even, you know, game two set aside, where the whole team seemed to flop. Mm-hmm. I just look at Carey Price's all the work he's done this year, both with Team Canada at the Olympics and with the Montreal Canadiens. And I think back to 1993 when Patrick Roy had that amazing playoff, the last time a Canadian-based team won the Stanley Cup. Patrick was 26 years old. Mm. Carey Price is 26 years old. So the similarities are there. Of course, Patrick had to win 10 games in overtime. And I don't think anybody's ever going to go through that again. But again, I will say the thing that impresses me most about Carey Price, and you can even take it back to a couple of years ago when he played poorly in a preseason game and he said to people, come on, relax, chill out. That's what this Montreal Canadiens team needs against a team that's ahead of them in the standings, the Boston Bruins. I think they need a goaltender who's calm. If he had had an absolute meltdown after that loss, swung his stick, he would have given license to the rest of his players to act the same way. He didn't do that, and I think the players look at him and go, wow, our goalie doesn't have a meltdown. What right do we have to have a meltdown?
Does it remind you, and you mentioned 93, and I said this about a week ago, and I was covering the Tampa-Montreal series, I said, it's starting to feel a little bit like 93. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but it's just that feeling on the team, balanced scoring, no superstars up front, but balanced scoring, a superstar goalie in Carey Price, a superstar on the blue line, maybe a couple when you add in Markov and Subban, what they're able to do and how they can impact a game. Is it starting to feel a little bit like 93?
It really does, because when you look at the 93 team, who was their leading points guy? Was it Vinny Damfus?
Might have been.
Vinny Damfus, who was a very good hockey player, but not a superstar. And that's the character of this Montreal Canadiens. There isn't that one go-to superstar guy. It's a real team effort, and I still think they're dark horses. You look at Chicago, LA, and the Boston Bruins, to me, are still the three favorites to win the Stanley Cup. But with each passing day, with each passing game, I'm starting to buy into this Montreal Canadiens. And you know, we live in a country that has seven Canadian-based franchises, and we haven't had a Stanley Cup champion in Canada since 1993. I'm a little surprised more Canadians across the country aren't hopping on the bandwagon a little bit more.
People are starting to drink the Kool-Aid, and there is a bit of momentum. They've got a lot of work to do. But again, if they knock off the Bruins in this series, I imagine they're going to go into the Eastern Conference Final as the favorite, regardless if it's the Rangers or the Penguins that they face. So there's some momentum building in Montreal tomorrow night, Game 4, of course, right here on CBC. Another question rolling your way. Courtesy of Mary P. Subban is really lighting it up this series. Again, not questions. People are just wanting to share their opinions. And this is a pretty straight up opinion. 11 points for Subban in the playoffs. That's third now in the NHL.
Well, what do you say about a guy who went pointless in the opening night of the playoffs and has points in every game since? Mm-hmm. He's got 11 points in his last six games. He's got three multi-point games, three goals in the series against the Boston Bruins. He's a physical guy, and he had to face that crap with the racism on Twitter. Mm-hmm. And I really think that because of the type of guy he is, he just shrugged that off and said, you know what, I'm gonna take that nonsense and use it as my launching pad to play the best hockey that I've ever played. And listen, we're talking about a guy who already has a Norris Trophy in his hip pocket, and now he's going out leading an underdog team against a powerhouse team, like the Boston Bruins. And isn't it coincidental? There's a contract on the table.
Yeah, and we'll touch on that in a second. But I don't want to make a point that people are looking at the goals. We saw the beautiful breakaway goal there, but it's also these stretch passes. We saw it against Tampa, the flip pass to Rene Bork's bringing him. We saw it again last night and in game two, these long stretch passes setting guys in on breakaways. So
well, that's I was going to say, you know, the way guys are scoring goals coming out of the penalty box, I'd almost want to take a couple penalties. You know, PK joined
or
the
decline.
Club
if you're the other team, we decline it. No, keep them on the ice. You know, you bring up the contract. He's an RFA. Let me throw this out at you. Why don't we see a team, and I forget, I don't know what team, but why don't we see a team say, okay, 8 years, whatever. Throw a huge amount of money, I guess if you're, you know, seven, with the new CBA, you can only throw out seven, but throw out a huge amount of money and force the Canadiens' hands to sign him to that type of deal.
I wouldn't be surprised if you actually see that, although PK, for some reason, I just can't picture him in another uniform other than the Montreal Canadiens, but when the money starts talking, suddenly you can envision different things, but you're absolutely
right. He's 24 years old.
Yes.
I mean, why not build around this guy?
And he's getting better. In my point, my point of view is he's actually getting better, even though he has won a Norris Trophy. I think he's got a long way to go in terms of settling it down his defensive game and maturing on the ice. I just think he's a wonderful player, and I would not be shocked on any level if somebody tossed that multi-year contract his way.
Rarely see that. We did see it, of course, Philadelphia with Shea Weber offering up what was a 14-year deal, forcing Nashville's hand to sign him to what was a pretty crazy deal, maybe a deal they're hoping to, you know, get out of at some point. We will see how things roll now with Peter Laviolette running the show.
I wonder if Laviolette would have taken that job. I'm sure that was the first question he asked. What are you going to do with Shea Weber? Because I don't. He had his choice probably of a couple jobs. I'm guessing they're going to keep Shea Weber for the short term at least.
And it's funny because Laviolette would have been his coach had the offer sheet gone through to Philadelphia. So here it is now. He'll be the head coach in Nashville. There is another series taking place again. Game four tonight at MSG. New York, I won't call it a must win, but they've been shut out in back-to-back games. Marc-Andre Fleury's looked good. Your thoughts here going into game four on home ice, the sixth game in nine nights for the Rangers. Fatigue's been a big question in this series.
Well, there's no question. I mean, as reporters, we're getting tired watching that many hockey games. So can you imagine how it is playing them? The bad news for the New York Rangers, and there's plenty of bad news to go for the New York Rangers, is this guy finally got off the schneid and scored a goal. And, you know, Sidney has one goal and 7 points in nine games. Very un-Sidney-like numbers. But the good news for the Penguins is, of course, in the last two games, he's looked very much like vintage Sidney Crosby. I look at look at these two guys talking about the Stanley Cup they won with the Tampa Bay Lightning, and they look just a little bit older on this New York Rangers team. Marty St. Louis, no points in the last five games.
What about Rick Nash? My goodness.
Well, Rick Nash, I was going to mention, no points in the last seven games. He has no goals in 10 games in the playoffs. If it's Marty St. Louis and Brad Richards that has to lead this hockey team, and it's not Nash and it's not Stepan, you're in a lot of trouble, because at their age, I'm saying Marty St. Louis is a great player still, but he shouldn't be the go-to guy on this hockey team. A young guy like Rick Nash should be the go-to guy. He has been an absolute bitter disappointment throughout his entire NHL career in the playoffs.
I'll leave you with this. Is it a must-win for New York?
Oh, yeah, it really is, because I think they're, with, as you mentioned, the fatigue, the tiredness, it's crept into their heads now. It's part of the daily conversation. And with Sidney, getting stronger, you worry, oh, boy, what are we going to do to stop him if he gets playing Sidney Crosby-type hockey?
Three straight losses, perhaps, rolling into Pittsburgh in a must-win situation for Game 5, an untenable situation for the Rangers. So keep an eye on that, of course. We got it for you tonight here, Hockey Night in Canada, Pittsburgh and the Rangers, Game 4. And again, if you want to reach out to us, we want your thoughts, your ideas, your questions, at Hockey Night, at David Amber, at Hockey Bro, hashtag Hockey Night. And then tonight's game, here it is, Pittsburgh and the Rangers. This is as close to a must-win as you're going to see. The Rangers cannot go down 3-1 in this series.
You're absolutely right.
Enjoy the game tonight. We'll see you same place, same time tomorrow. It's Hockey Night Online on cbcsports.ca.